We're going to continue our series today on gratefulness, as the children told you. And I think you got an idea of what scripture we're talking about. It's going to be from Luke, and it will be chapter 17, verses 11 through 19. And I think you have a pretty good idea why we chose the word grateful for the title for this series. We're in November. It's a gratitude month. It's a month when we give Thanksgiving and think about Thanksgiving. So we decided we'd do a series on what exactly does gratitude look like. We can have to say thanks all we want, but to show our thanks is something totally different. So we started by reminding ourselves that we're here, but why we worship God in the first place. I don't know if you remember, but we talked about we worship God because God has done something amazing for us that we couldn't do for ourselves. And we need to be grateful, so we worship God. Week one, we saw that one of the most powerful ways to worship God is what? You're doing it. Be quiet. To get in a quiet place, close the door, and be with God, and pray, and just be in God's presence, to be still in His presence. So we determined to show our thanks to God by doing a challenge. You remember what that was? Find a quiet place, slow pace, be alone, and pray face to face. I hope that many of you did that again this week. However, I'm not encouraged because you don't even remember what it was. But we can do it and try it again, okay? Try it. It works. Just slow down. Take 5 minutes, 10 minutes, and pray to God. So when Jesus talked to us about going away to a quiet place, and He instructed us to pray, and He said that that's a powerful way to show God that you're thankful. And there's some other ways that we can show Him too. Last week, we talked about a word that most people don't fully understand. The word was praise. How can we praise God? And we asked to pray for today's worship, as I said, so that we experience and that we can move our feet. We can shout amen. We can let the Spirit go and feel it and experience worship, not just come and be lumps on a log and sit on our hands. So we are doing that, and we want that to be alive. It's a way of saying to God, we're so grateful, and we need it. We need to feel that and be re-energized by worship. Then we get gratitude. So I pray that you will continue to do that. Continue to pray for our worship to be so Spirit-filled and overwhelming, and that we will just relax and let ourselves be and let ourselves worship God so that we can experience that. You know, growing up, this time of year, I'd have to say it was one of my favorite times of year. Because for me, anyway, it meant that we traveled and I got to see cousins and friends and family that I hadn't seen for quite a while. And we would get together and play games and we would do the things that are traditional. I'll talk about in a minute, pick names for Christmas or watch some football, eat lots of turkey, fight with my cousins after an hour, whatever it was. But it always meant family, being together and seeing people I hadn't seen. And when you say the word Thanksgiving at this time of the year, it brings up certain emotions. It brings up certain memories. It brings up certain traditions that are in your lives and images that you've experienced over the years. And especially when it comes to food, right? Everybody has their own special dressing or recipe or something, or a little something special that we have together. Do you know that there will be over 50 million turkeys eaten on Thursday in the United States alone? 50 million turkeys. 80 million pounds of cranberries will be scarfed down. Football has become a big tradition at Thanksgiving. And like I said, drawing for names for Christmas. But of all the traditions, none of them is quite as moving as after everybody gathers around the table and someone is selected to say grace. It's a quiet moment when the family all bows their head together and collectively gives thanks to God for God's blessings and supply in our lives. It's a moment of worship where we stop together as a family to pause and pray and say, thank you, God. Thank you. Thank you. So as we continue our series, I want to focus on a form of thanksgiving that all of us could really stand to do more often. Let's open our Bibles to a really unlikely thanksgiving story here in Luke 7, 11 through 19. Let me just give you a quick synopsis of this story, and then we're going to look a little closer, okay? So verse 11. Now, on his way to Jerusalem, Jesus traveled along the border between Samaria and Galilee. As he was going into the village, 10 men who had leprosy met him. Now you all know, you heard what I told the kids, and you know what leprosy is like. These guys are ostracized, they're out, they stood at a distance because they were required to, and they shout out in a loud voice to Jesus, Jesus, Master, have pity on us. A couple of things I want us to notice here. Obviously, the word had gotten out that Jesus was healing lepers, because it happened in chapter 5, verse 12 through 15 as well. And I want you to also notice what they call him. Jesus, Master. That word Master, there's two kinds of forms of that word. One emphasized the teaching aspect of Jesus. Master, like a teacher, and a master teacher, like when he met with Nicodemus. But this word that's used here is only used six times in the New Testament. The word for master here emphasized authority. Authority is supernatural, something supernatural about this master that you're talking to. In other words, these lepers were crying out, and they believed that Jesus had the authority to heal them, that he could actually do it. These 10 guys on the side of the road saw Jesus as someone who could change their lives forever. They saw him as a Messiah, not just some prophet or some teacher, but God that could heal them. They saw him as God. And then Jesus does something really unexpected. Back in Luke 5, he actually walks up to the leper, touches the leper, and heals the leper. The leper says, Jesus, have mercy, will you heal me? And he said, I will. Be healed. When he saw these 10 guys, he said to them, go and show yourselves to the priest. He didn't even touch these guys. He simply spoke to them. He didn't even say, I will be healed. He told them to go to the priest. Why? Why was that? And it says, because when they went, as they went, they were cleansed. It meant they had to have faith in what he told them to do for them to be healed. And these guys, their faith really amazes me. I mean, think about it for a minute. Before they could see any physical signs of healing, they simply obeyed Jesus. They went to show themselves to the priest. All 10 of these guys had great faith. Great faith. I wish I had that kind of faith sometimes. I tend to hesitate, and sometimes I even argue with God. Sometimes I just say, come on, God, let's work this out, or why aren't you working, whatever. Anyway, these guys, Jesus said, jump. And they said, how high? Go show yourself to the priest. Boom, they're gone. And that's the end of the story for 9 of these lepers. If it weren't for that 10th leper, we wouldn't even have our lesson for today. You see, only one of these lepers did that something extra. If it hadn't been for this 10th leper, we would have read this story and read this scripture and stopped right there. And we would have said, wow, Jesus healed those guys and he didn't even touch them. And did you see those guys? Wow, they had faith, didn't they? Huh? Look, they just believed and they ran to the priest before there was even any evidence of them being healed. Those guys rock. And that's what we tend to do when we hear stories like that. We love the sensational part. We love the thought that if we just have faith in Jesus Christ, he will heal us and all of our sin. And that is true. If you are here today and you will have faith in Jesus. He will cleanse you of the leprosy of your sin. He will wash you clean. He will give you a brand new start. It's true. It's true. The fact is, every human being is suffering from a sinfulness much more deadly and much more contagious than leprosy. Every human being. And you know what it is? It's called sin. No one is exempt or immune. No one. Did you get that? No one? If you die without being healed, you will pay for it in eternity. We've all broken God's law, and we have all contracted the disease of sin. We are outcasts. We cannot enter in the presence of a holy, righteous God because of our sin. Cannot do it. God cannot allow the sin sick to enter the kingdom of heaven. So without admitting we're sinners and that we need healing, we are destined to spend an eternity in hell. Without admitting. But right now, in this moment, if you will have the faith of these 10 lepers, and you will call out to Jesus to have mercy on you, He will. He will. That's the good news. Now for the rest of the story. Verse 15. One of them, when he saw he was healed, came back praising God in a loud voice. Notice those words, came back. Would you please? You circle them if you want to. You know what those two words mean? Do you know what they mean? They mean that this guy remembered and he returned. The other nine guys were excited about seeing the priest because they knew as soon as they saw the priest and the priest declared him clean, they would be free. And they would be healed and ready to go back to their families. And you can't blame them for that, can you? No telling how long these guys have been sick with leprosy and how long they've been living as outcasts. Some of them probably had not seen their children in years. They hadn't slept with their wives. They hadn't even shook hands with their friends. They hadn't so much as given anyone, except maybe one of their other leper homeless teen guys, a high five in years. They were outcasts. So they're excited. They want to return home. But here's the point. This is why this 10th leper story is so important to us. The other nine lepers proved the point made by James later in his epistle when he said, faith without works is dead. I am convinced that if those 10 guys had heard Jesus say, go show yourselves to the priest, and they would have just looked at each other and said, what? What is he talking about? You mean you're not even going to touch us, Jesus? You're not even going to say to us, be healed? Well, forget that. Forget that. I am convinced if they had done that, they would not have been healed. Faith without works is dead. They would have remained lepers if they had not obeyed Jesus' instructions. And here's what we learned from that one leper who returned to come back and thank God. Here's what we learned. Faith without works is rude. Faith without works is rude. That one leper teaches us that part of living a life of faith is remembering to return and say thanks to God. Now, I don't know about you, but I get really convicted when I read this part of the story. I know there have been so many times that God has blessed me, healed me, taken care of me. God has protected me, but I have failed to return and thank God. I know I've returned to thank Him for it. I've proven the point more times than I would like to admit. Faith without thanks is rude. You ever gone out of your way like I asked the kids to help somebody and they don't thank you? I remember once that I was walking into a store and I could see in the glass window a little old lady coming up behind me. She was walking along kind of slow. So I stopped and I held the door open for her. And she got to the door and took off her rain hat, pulled it up, put it in her purse, moved her purse, got a couple things out, put something else in. Then leaned over and looked in the door next to her to fix her hair. And I'm standing there holding the door. And then she walks by me like I'm not even there, not even looking in my direction. Didn't say thanks, didn't say anything else. Like, what am I, a mannequin? So, no thanks, honey, no nothing. No thank you, not even a smile. So I tripped her. No. But I wanted to. Now, I'm not sure if you have a story like that or not, but we all know what it feels like to be unappreciated, don't we? When we go out of our way to do something helpful or nice for someone, and they don't even say thank you. You know, you don't do it for that, but you do expect them to take time to say thank you. Now, before we get on those other nine lepers case here, let me ask you a question. How long has it been since you have stopped everything else you were doing, remembered and returned to thank God for what he's done for you lately? Was it last Thanksgiving? Maybe your last meal that you stopped to thank God? Those don't count, okay? I mean, it's good to say thank you for this food that we're about to eat and all of that, but what about expressing gratitude to God for saving you? What about thanking God for saving you, for protecting you, for guiding you, for providing your needs for you? Look at how thankful this 10th leper was. Look at how thankful he was. In verse 16, he threw himself at Jesus' feet and thanked him, and he was a Samaritan. He was really, really thankful. Thankful. Oh, God, I'm so thankful. He was thankful. So much so that it showed in his actions. It wasn't just a wave over his shoulder as he's running to see the priest and, hey, thanks, Jesus, I'm on my way to see the priest. No, he threw himself at his feet. And we know that it bothered Jesus that these other guys didn't even take time to pause and thank him. Look at verse 17. Jesus asked, were not all 10 cleansed? Where are the other 9? Was no one found to return to give praise to God except this foreigner? And then he said to him, rise and go. Your faith has made you well. Faith without works is dead, but faith without thanks is rude. It's just rude. So what are some practical ways, real quick, that we can return and show that I'm truly thankful to God for his salvation, for his mercy, for his grace, for his provisions, for all he provides? I want to suggest 3 things real quick to you. Don't miss these. The ways for us to show we are grateful to God. First, it's all about returning. And the first one is, guess what? Returning to church. This is a place that continually helps us remember what God has done for us. That's what it's here for. That's what we are here for. For his mercy, for his grace, for his provisions. We return to hang out with his people on a regular basis out of gratitude. Now, I understand that I am preaching to the wrong people today for the most part. You are here. But let me ask you something. How consistent are you about coming to church? When there's a choice between coming to church and doing something else, how often do you choose church? It's sad to say, and I'm not getting on anybody's case. If you're convicted, it's the Holy Spirit. Take it up with that. But it's sad to say, some of you may be here today because you didn't really have anything else to do. Every time you choose to wake up on Sunday morning and get ready and come to church, you know what you're doing? You're returning thanks to God. You are saying, thank you, God. I know we get busy. I know we get offended. It's church people. I know sometimes we are tired and we could use a little rest on Sunday morning. But if you really, really want to return thanks to God on a regular basis, you will choose to return to church to be with God's people and thank Him. And I'll tell you, Romans 14:6 can put a little stamp on that for you. Those who worship the Lord on a special day, do it to honor Him. Do it to honor Him. Return to church. Another thing you can do, return to give. Return to give. Another practical way I can say thank God is by returning His tithe. Tithing is an act of obedience because we are choosing to return something to God that has already belongs to Him. It's like sharing something with someone who gave it to you to start with. What if someone brought a birthday cake to your birthday party and you didn't share the cake with them? That would be wrong, wouldn't it? Sure it would. It'd be rude. It's just natural for us to share with someone who has shared with us. And God has shared with us. He has given us everything that we have. Look around you. If you see something, God gave it to you. For us to be stingy with what God has given us that doesn't belong to us, and to be stingy with it, is the height of ingratitude. For us to be stingy with what God gave us. Psalm 24:1 said, "The earth is the Lord's and everything in it." Everything. That includes everything in it. Third way we can do thanks and show thanks, return to serve. Return to serve. When you're truly thankful for what God has done for you, you'll begin to look for ways to serve others. It's a natural response. Serving is a natural response to gratitude. We serve others to show God's goodness to them. Now let me ask you a question. What do you call someone who constantly receives? Someone who is constantly being served, fed, dressed, changed, and pampered, but doesn't do anything? A baby. You may have a lot of excuses why you don't serve or minister to others, but there's only one real reason. And that is immaturity, Christian immaturity. Galatians 5:13 says, use your freedom to serve one another in love. Here's the point. Returning thanks is more than just saying thank you. Returning thanks will cost you something. It will cost you something. This Thanksgiving, how about this? How about we do a little remembering, okay? Think of all the good things that God has done for you. Who are you going to be more like this Thanksgiving? The 9 lepers who were healed and didn't come back? Or the one who remembered what Jesus had done for him and returned to give thanks? Which one are you? Are you returning to church regularly? Are you returning to give consistently? Are you returning to serve God by serving others frequently? Do you need healing today? Do you need healing? Have you ever been healed of the disease of sin? Have you? Pray right now for Jesus to forgive you. Pray right now for Jesus to forgive you and heal you. Here's this week's challenge. Last week you were challenged to find a quiet place and be in God's presence and pray for worship this week to be spirit-filled. And now, I'm asking you, I'm challenging you in one of your quiet times this week, I want you to find your quiet place and pray. But for the entire time that you pray, I want you to thank God for as many things as you can possibly think of without ever asking for one thing. Thank God for all you can think of without asking for one thing. Now to close, I want to take this opportunity for all of us to give thanks together before we leave, okay? Just to take a minute to thank God, and I want to do that by action. John's going to play some music, and I'm going to invite you to come up, to stand at the altar, kneel at the altar for a minute. Just give thanks to God. Can we do that as a body of Christ? We'll see. It's open. I invite you to come.